Oh, okay, so we're coming towards Easter and looking at how we prepare our hearts for Christ's passion and resurrection and life that he gives to us. And so today for a scripture, I want us to look at 1 John chapter 3, beginning in verse 16. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees their neighbor in need, but has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with actions and in truth. This then is how we know that we belong to the truth, and how we set our hearts at rest in his presence whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. If our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God and receive from him anything we ask, because we obey his commands and we do what pleases him. And this is his command, to believe in the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he commanded us. Those who obey his commands live in him and he in them. And this is how we know that he lives in us. We know it by the spirit that he gave us. So pray with me. Lord, teach us today from your word. Teach us what love is. Teach us how we might have a new confidence in your presence, and that we could live our lives without fear and having the courage to lay down our lives for those around us. That's our need today. That's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, one thing that I struggle with probably my whole life is this thing of confidence. So when I see a passage like this that says, here's how you have confidence, I think I should pay attention to that. Now, I've survived not having confidence. You know, I've got this far, you know. May not get much further, but, you know, so far. And one of the ways I did it was incredible brashness. That's one way to pretend to have confidence, even though we don't have it. I learned early as the class clown that you can distract and you can fool people into thinking that you're confident. Another way, though, that I dealt with my lack of confidence was just the reality of insecurity. And I have found that, maybe I'm gifted this way, I can be insecure in almost any situation, in almost any relationship, in almost any setting, I can be insecure. And it's served me well, you know. Basically, you know, all the books that I've written are books about, you know, living life insecure. That's bestsellers, you know. So maybe there's a couple other people who are struggling with this. Or they're married to someone who's struggling with this and they buy the book for them. You know, that always works. But, and then the third way that I try and deal with my lack of confidence is I can turn shy, kind of hide away, not get myself in front of people. And then, you know what that does? It's really cool. It makes them come to you. It makes them seek you out. So it's actually a really manipulative thing. Maybe that's the essence of sin, is shyness. Oh my gosh. But anyway, so I did those three: brashness, insecurity, and shyness. And I kind of would rotate them. Never once feeling confident. So I look at this passage and I go, God doesn't want us trying to handle things our own way through our, you know, rashness, insecurity, or shyness. What he wants is for us to have confidence, to have boldness, and have boldness before him. And it says that this confidence comes when the phrase in the Bible is our hearts condemn us. Our hearts condemn us, not other people, our own. And I think that this is a great reference, a great description of the shame that some of us, you know, carry with us. And so we don't need other people saying, well, you don't measure up, because you know what? We're already saying it. Hey, you don't measure up. F. So, I used to hear that from my dad all the time, but he's been dead for many years, and I don't need him around. I can still keep saying it, you know. What are you thinking? But when our hearts don't condemn us, when there's a healing of the shame, so we have confidence before God. And I want us to look at that and see, how do we live out the implications of shame-free or shame-healed lives in which we have this confidence before God? And it's interesting, I looked up the word that was used in the Greek here for confidence, and it means bluntness, impulsiveness, being rash. That's the words that they use to describe this confidence. And I thought about it, and I thought, all those things are, you're not having to be careful about what you say. When you're in the presence of God, you don't have to worry about getting everything right, or sounding good, or having everything seem in order. You can actually be like a little kid, impulsive, and just say stuff. And there's no judgment, because it's all an atmosphere of love. I thought, isn't that cool? That total freedom to not have to worry about, did we get it right? Did we say it right? Did we get our every little belief right? Did we do? Or can we just have fun in the presence of the Lord? That would be cool. Now, it says, this is love. Jesus laid down his life for us. We're going to be celebrating that at Easter time. Jesus laid down his life for us. And then, so we should then lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. Now, the key to this for me is that Jesus laid down his life. It wasn't taken from him. He offered it. And that is really important. I really hate it when people try to take stuff from me. You ever get that? Where you're going, what do they want? What are they trying to get? What? And I start to get real defensive. That's totally different than when you decide to offer up something. Why is it different? It's because all the power shifts. When you offer something up, it's who decides, right? If they're deciding to take it from you, heck no. If you offer it up, nobody's taking it from you. You're making your own decision to do this. And there's a freedom in that. So when Jesus, in Philippians 2, it says, Jesus didn't consider equality with God as something to be grasped onto. I love that image, you know, just hang on. I'm entitled. This is mine. I've got this. He didn't consider it something to be physically grasped onto, but he gave it up and took on the form of a servant. Right? He emptied himself. That's so important, because there's a freedom in looking at the people around us and saying, I don't need to hold on to what I got. I don't need to hold on to what who I am. I don't need to hold on to what I've achieved. I can give that up in order to make their life better. You know? And so we lay down our lives. Now, one of the ways, and we've talked about this over the years, you know, so this is kind of a Westfall thing, okay? So I get that. One of the ways that we lay down our lives in our setting is that we actually honestly and authentically share our lives. We share what we're going through. We share with people our issues and our unresolved things and our struggles and our joys and we share that authentically, not manipulatively, and not to try and get a response from them, but we just lay down our lives. Here's my life. In order to encourage them. And this is so powerful because so few people do it. Vulnerability, we've talked about this, doesn't get rewarded very much. And so the idea of being where somebody shares a struggle they have and instead of telling them the right things they need to do to fix it, instead, we share, well, you know, I struggle in a similar way. I'm hoping God meets me there. And they go, really? God can meet you there? Maybe God can meet me there. And there's a connection that happens. When we're vulnerable. And one of the ways we can... Sheila knows this. I've spent most of my ministry in the middle of worship wars. You know, they're funny little things. I've learned, though, as a pastor, it's insightful. It's only taken me, I don't know, all these years to figure out that people like what they like. You know? And they don't like what they don't like. Isn't that weird? And if you like something or you like things a certain way, it doesn't matter what other people like. Why? Because it's what I like that counts, right? I always see this in worship, even here in the harbor, I can't make the actual quote, but it was, there's young people here. When are you going to stop those F-bombing drums? I said, probably a lot longer than you think it ought to be. they like what they like. So I told that person, you know, I don't get my way ever. Here, at home, anywhere, I don't get my way. So what makes you think you're going to get yours? I can share that because that person's not here this morning. look around. I think I've shared this story with you, but I clipped it out of the newspaper because it just really struck me as people want what they want, right? So, this story from the newspaper. A Tupperware saleswoman from Fresno. Okay, right there. Right there. You know where this story's going, right? Yeah, I don't even need to finish it. A Tupperware saleswoman from Fresno was in jail yesterday after a dispute over country music turned into a brawl in a hotel. According to police, Stephanie Albers was sitting in the bar at the Marriott Hotel at 1:30 in the morning when she decided that the music the disc jockey was playing wasn't country and wasn't acceptable. Now, I understand that. You know, in heaven, there's two kinds of music, country and western. Get used to it, okay? Here's a quote. The Burlingame Police Commander Gary Missel said, "The woman wanted to hear some Garth Brooks and it wasn't being played." Albers, who police said had been drinking, There's mysteries in life, isn't there? Yeah. Had been drinking, started making loud remarks about the music, and it was loud enough for the disc jockey's girlfriend to hear. The two women began arguing about the music when Albers warned the other woman to, quote, get a long little doggie. That's the way they talk in Fresno at the time. When the argument continued, police said, Albers, who was reportedly 190 pounds, slugged the 115-pound Milbrae woman, then wrestled her to the ground. When the disc jockey jumped into the fray, he was socked in the jaw before he could throw any punches of his own. Police separated the fighters. The Milbrae woman was taken to the hospital where she was treated for 3 broken ribs. Albers is booked in jail and remains in custody on suspicion of assault. You know, when you like something, it doesn't matter what other people want. It doesn't matter what other people do. We want our way. Now, there is no confidence in our lives before God if we have to have our way. Trust me, I know this. Confidence comes when we, like Jesus, lay down our lives for others. And then the shame that we carry with us that reminds us that we don't measure up begins to lose its grip on us. Because we don't have to defend ourselves against our own heart's accusations, right? I want to tell you about something that happened a little over a week ago. I got a call, and so I went and did a funeral, a memorial service for one of the senior vice president execs for the Sonics basketball team. And then when the Sonics left and went to Tulsa, he went with them, and he's the senior exec for the Oklahoma City Thunder, right? Which really are the Sonics, okay, we know that. Okay. Pete Weinmiller, You knew him, and I'd done his wedding with Cindy years ago, and so Cindy called and asked if I'd do his service. So the thing about Pete was that he had his faith, and he believed his passage. We should find a way to love people tangibly. If Jesus laid down his life for us and loves us, and we have confidence in that, we should be able to find a way to tangibly love other people, right? And it's hard to get from we ought to love people, we ought to lay down our life, to actually, what does that look like? What tangible things can we do if we're actually loving people like that? So he thought about it in terms of people who come to an NBA game, which was his working world, and he thought, how can we love them and lay down our lives for them so that they have the kind of experience where they feel so loved and cared for that it doesn't matter if the team wins or loses, doesn't matter what happens. And so he started thinking about what he could do and how he could treat people to tangibly love people the way Jesus loved him. Now, have you ever been to a sporting event? First of all, it's weird, okay? And a lot of weird people there. And I was told, you know, by someone who knows the difference between the Mariners and the Seahawks fans is teeth. I'm just saying, I don't know. But the NBA is a whole different situation. And Pete realized that if somebody is treated rudely by the parking lot attendant, it will color their whole experience at the game. If someone asks the question of an usher and gets a rude answer, it will affect them and forever change the way they feel about it. So he set out to say, okay, how can we love people who come into our presence? How do we love them like Jesus loved us? And it's really amazing that he actually came up with this. But anyway, the NBA now has just announced this week that they are going to give an annual Pete Weinmiller Award for teams and individuals who creatively, excellently find ways to love people. But this is what he came up with. And it's a, you know, because business people do this, they have little ways of putting it together. So his is click. Okay, I'm going to tell you what that, you know. So the first one is, he had this permeate all the way down through the organization. The first thing is to communicate courteously, not rudely, not indifferently, but with kindness. Don't cut people off, but communicate, you know, in a kind way. Now that's obvious, right? We all want that. But then the second one was listen to learn and not just to respond. So to learn to listen. Now we're not talking about like the parking lot attendant. Listening. To learn from people. And that involves, you know, looking people in the eye and telling them important, letting them know that they're important and they're not just one more person coming through the turnstile, you know. We gotta get more head of cattle through here, you know. But to take people seriously enough to listen to them. And the I was to initiate immediately. There's nothing worse than when, have you ever wandered around somewhere and wondered how things worked, or you know, where's the bathrooms, or you know, something like that. But when you see somebody, go up and initiate it, and kind of the way Jesus initiated in our lives. He didn't wait for us to come around. He came to us and said, "Come, follow me. Trust me. Let me love you." And so starting to initiate. And then let's see, C was create connections. You know? And the last one was know your stuff. You know? Well-meaning ignorance isn't helpful, you know? But know your stuff. And so he had this click thing, you know? And at the funeral, I said, you know, if our churches ever could figure out how to do Pete's click, it would be an amazing transformational thing. And all it was for him was, what can we do to lay down our lives, set aside our entitlements, our privilege, our situation, so that others could be blessed? It's love tangibly. Now, we've spent a lot of our lives having our hearts condemn us. And if we know, let me read this again. We belong to the truth, to Jesus. We set our hearts at rest whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts. God is greater than the accusations, and so we have no need to self-defend. We have no need to demand our own way, our own personal tastes. We have no need to grasp what's ours. But we have this incredible opportunity to do what Jesus did, which is to relax our grip, authentically, vulnerably lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters.
there is incredible power in being included. There's incredible power in being listened to, people coming towards us, initiating. There's power in being accepted, included, and loved, right? We all know that. I mean, that's why we're here, because there's power. There's power for us, there's power through us. It's a very, very significant thing, because inclusion overcomes shame. Inclusion says you're part, you're welcome, you're loved. And I think that's what Jesus did at the very end, before his crucifixion, when he gathered his friends together and for one last meal, brought them in, even the betrayer, or the betrayers, even them, come on in, you're part of this. You're loved regardless. And he broke the bread and he poured the wine and he said, take and eat this bread and drink this cup as a proclamation of my death. As a proclamation of my death. Our hearts cannot condemn us when we realize we're loved. There's no room for that condemnation. And I think Jesus knew that, and he wanted us repeatedly to remind each other, you belong, you're part of this. Jesus died for you, he died for me. We don't have to claim our stuff.
stop it.